We think this is important for three reasons. One, it stabilizes, fortifies, and dramatically expands the base the business can operate from. Two, it penetrates markets from many different vantage points. Please, whoever's got the phone, turn it off. Three, it gives you access to markets and people that your competitors couldn't have. And there's actually a fourth. You're hedged. If anything goes wrong or stops working with the main approach you've been depending on, you're okay. You're well covered or hedged. We'll get into this deeply. And it also works on the geometry of your business, which I will show you mathematically in a couple of hours. Did we miss five? Okay. Was that how they've been doing it? Okay, so it's an error. Five over here. We got five over here and six over here. Being different, special, and advantageous in the eyes of your customers and clients. The key to everything is differentiating your business. Most people in business all over the world, and I dare say probably here in China, even more so because you've never thought about it, the key is making your business stand out more favorably in the eyes of your prospective buyers above and beyond the competition. And that is a strategic, it's a conscious, it's a very formulated thing you've got to do. And we'll teach you how to do it, but your goal should be to have your business and your products and your people stand out positively as being different, special, and more advantageous in the eyes of the people you sell to. Number six, creating real value for your clients and employees for maximum loyalty and results. You noticed before we broke, the gentleman over here who'd been to my program in 2005 talked about how he shifted his focus from being self-focused to being externally focused and being much more sensitive, pardon me, to the needs, the desires, the interests of the buyer. That's fundamental to what I teach, and it's a very powerful competitive edge you will have when I get you to start doing this. But the key here is value means different things to different people. You may think the most valuable thing is the design of your product. You may think that the most valuable thing is that you will work, you know, around the clock for the buyer. But if the buyer doesn't think on the same level, if he or she doesn't appreciate what you think is value, it's useless. You've got to shift your focus to what they think is valuable, not what you think is valuable. The key to great success is what's called the you attitude. And you doesn't mean you, it means you, the buyer, you, the client, you, the patient, the people who buy products and services from you. It's all about them, it's not about you. And that's going to be a foundation we're going to be talking about all week. Gaining the maximum personal, it's number seven, gaining the maximum personal leverage from every action, investment, time, or energy commitment you ever make. Now this obviously is super logical, but ironically and sadly, almost no business owners anywhere, not just in China, do this. In order to get the maximum leverage possible from every action you take, every investment of time, energy, or money that you make, you've got to have an understanding and an appreciation of a lot more possibility. We call this learning optimization. Optimization is getting the maximum result, the highest and best outcome from the minimal effort, risk, time, or investment. But you cannot optimize until you first get a better understanding of not all, but many more options, possibilities, alternatives, and opportunities out there. That is why I want to give you the benefit of showing you how all kinds of different businesses sell market. That's why I want to give you the benefit of seeing how all kinds of different people interpret the same experience you've had. That's why I want to give you the chance to look at how many more powerful ways you have of reaching, selling, retaining your buyers than your competitor uses. And it's just a process of expanding your sense of what really is possible. Networking, masterminding, brainstorming with like-minded, success-driven people who share real-life experiences and shortcuts with you. The odds are extremely high that if I do my job correctly over the next 3 days and you cooperate and collaborate by sharing your perspectives at the table, your realizations out in the corridor with people, you're going to be masterminding and networking at a level of creative possibility you can't even fathom. If you study the greatest achievers in all of business history, almost to the man or woman, as bright as they all were, they all had an advisory team, a board of directors, a collection of mentors to give them perspectives from outside their industry. Benefit of having already walked where they're trying to travel. That's what you get when you mastermind with quality, high integrity, highly ambitious, open-minded, creative, and dedicated people. So it's very important to accelerating your success. Turning yourself into an idea generator and a recognized innovator within your industry, field, or market. Now, this is probably a little bit sensitive, maybe even scary in your culture, because I don't know that the culture is one that's real innovative, but innovation does not need to be scary. All it really means is being somebody who constantly brings greater benefit, greater advantage, greater results, greater protection, greater enrichment, greater experiences to their buyer market than their competitors do. And you should strive to do that constantly, because with each level you increase the contribution you make to the marketplace, you double or redouble or double again the profits your business will make now and in the future. That's the same one. Remember what we're missing? What's the other one? We're missing one, and I'll have to remember they left one off. I'll find it and share it with you later. That's the same one. Reversing the risk for both you and your buyers in everything you do, so the downside's almost zero and the upside's almost infinite. Now, this week, of all the things I'm going to tell you about, probably the scariest and the most awkward for you to embrace is going to be the concept of risk reversal. I'm going to explain how it works tomorrow, maybe later today. I'm going to show you why it's so important, and we're going to explore ways you can comfortably test and try it out. But basically, here's what it means. Anytime two people come together to transact any kind of business, one side is always asking the other, either knowingly or not, either verbally or not, one side is always sort of saying to the other, you got to take on more of the risk in this transaction than I am. And because risk is two kinds, risk is both tangible wasting money. And it's intangible, looking bad, making a mistake, being embarrassed. People oftentimes don't go forward and buy because they're afraid of the two risks, the tangible and the intangible. If you can understand what the risk factors are that keep people from saying yes instead of no, and you can reduce or eliminate some or all of them, it makes it easier for people to buy than to postpone a purchase. And we're going to look at all the neat ways you can do it. We're going to evaluate problems you might have because you might worry that people will take advantage of you. And we're going to give you examples from real world experiences that I've had around the world so you can see some reference models. But I just want to keep you focused on these 12 elements, except for we got to figure out what, you know what it is? Growth? Okay, the one that's missing is called having growth thinking as a continuous philosophy. Now, obviously you all want to grow, but the odds that you incorporate growth as a constant in all your business activities is very low. We had, for example, in the States, a client who took a company from a $1,000 US investment. He started part-time working from a table in his kitchen. And in about 8 years, he was doing $450 million US. And the reason he did it was threefold. He used a strategy that I'm going to share with you in about 10 minutes called the strategy of preeminence that distinguished his company beyond all the others. He used a philosophy of reverse engineering every day, week, month, year of his company, and knowing in advance what the company had to do by day, by market, by product, by salespeople, by ad, to hit the goals he set. And he had engineered into that plan a fail-safe in case his activities didn't work. He had alternatives and what he called hedges, additional approaches to use if he needed them. And he always knew exactly how his company was going to grow because he programmed it for growth. Most business owners, most entrepreneurs hope and wish their business will grow. They work very hard efforting, but they don't make growth thinking a constant part of everything they do. I strongly urge that you decide to do that. What was that? Hold on. Okay. Using small, safe tests to eliminate dangerous risks and adopting this funnel vision instead of tunnel vision. Most people don't realize this, but you don't have to risk effort, money, or even your self-esteem or your pride on anything. You can test very, very, very small, very conservatively, very safely, all kinds of selling, marketing, business growth propositions and see whether or not they show life before you ever have to commit anything major to it, so you'll never be disappointed, you'll never be embarrassed, you'll never waste a lot of money. You just have to learn how to do it, and we'll be teaching you that through this. As I said, I got to get you at least aware before I can get into the details. Okay, we already talked about that. Oh, this is very important. Great marketers are not born. They really aren't. They're made. That should be very exciting for each and every one of you. Because marketing is more of a science than an art. It's much easier. There are fundamentals that are absolutely predictable. There are laws that work anywhere in the world. They are based on human nature, and human nature has been the same everywhere in the world. There's a certain number of factors everyone responds to. You can all become very, very talented, gifted, and successful marketers. There's not one person in this room who can follow guidance, direction, and a formula who can't do it. You just got to figure what elements in that formula are going to work best for your unique situation. Same thing for strategists. Great strategists can be trained and made. And you guys have to all, and you girls, all have to be committed to becoming much more strategic. It's very important. Marketing and strategy are sciences. They can be taught, learned, and mastered by each and every one of you. Okay. I'm going to give you a very simple explanation right now. I think in your book, there's pages you can read. But most business owners are totally tactical. They just do things to get through the month, to make enough money to pay their expenses, and they got to go do it again. The leading companies are extremely strategic. They have a long-term growth plan that is driven by marketing and selling activities that are purposely designed to continuously bring people in and to evolve or migrate or progress them constantly forward to buy other things or to keep repurchasing and to keep referring. And it's a very systematic process. Strategic business people do not ever do anything that isn't going to advance, enhance, and bring them closer to their long-term strategic vision. Remember I talked earlier, before the break, that one of the defining factors of a great entrepreneur is the ability to leverage their passionate vision through other people's resources. Part of everything here is your ability to envision, to clearly perceive a bigger, a greater, a more prosperous future for your business and to see it as being so real in your mind and your heart that it's only a matter of time before you make it occur. So you always have to be strategic. Tactics, strategy is the overriding master game plan that everything else is designed to achieve. Tactics are the techniques or the elements designed to achieve that. Regrettably, most business owners and most SME, small, medium-sized entrepreneurs, are tactical. They just do whatever they can to make enough money to be able to do it again on the next month or the next week. And one of the keys that I want for each and every one of you from this week together, this 3 days together, is to be able to give you the ability to stop working so hard day to day in your business and start getting your business to work harder and harder, constantly and continuously and strategically for you. It's a very big desire that I have for you. It's my biggest hope. If I can do that, you're going to have such free time to grow the business and to prosper. But you got to get that. You got to think about this. Remember I told you mindset I got to do first? Because if you're not clear on what you should be shooting for, striving for, focused on, you'll never achieve it. You'll never create it. You'll never incorporate it into the way you do business. We already talked about strategy. We already talked about that. I think that there are three types of entrepreneurs or business owners. Ones that make things happen, ones that watch things happen, and ones to whom things keep happening too. And a lot of us don't realize where we are in that in those groupings. I would suggest that you do a little bit of soul searching and ask yourself very candidly and openly, am I somebody who makes things happen? Am I a doer? Am I a mover? Am I an achiever? Am I an innovator? Am I somebody committed to growth? Or have I been content to sort of be on the sidelines and just let it happen however it did? Or am I somebody who always complains and never takes responsibility for the growth and prosperity of my business? Because you should be willing and able to move very quickly up a rung. If you're somebody who makes things happen, you should commit to make bigger, better, greater things happen more often. If you're somebody who watches things happen, it's like the difference of being a spectator up in the stands watching a sporting event or being a player on the field. It's so much more exciting. It's so much more meaningful. It's so much more dimensional when you're in the game actually playing it. If you're somebody who has unintentionally allowed yourself to be a victim, there's no shame. The shame is continuing to do it. To say, hey, I'm not going to be a victim anymore. I'm going to be somebody who makes my future, who creates my success, who engineers my prosperity, and then commit and do it. Okay, we're going to focus on 7 sciences of masterful marketing through this process. See, are they broken up individually? Yeah. First one are hidden assets. What are hidden assets? Well, hidden assets could be a category of buyers that you have who would be perfect buyers for lots of other products or services you've never thought of selling them and could make you a windfall profit of tens or hundreds of thousands of dollars or RMBs very quickly if you only recognize that they exist. A hidden asset might be the fact that you've got a promotion you do once a year and it does really well that you've never thought about doing it all the time. Just because it didn't make sense for you to do it, but if you did it 10 times instead of 1, it might produce 20 times more business for you. Overlooked opportunities. Overlooked opportunity might be we're going to talk very extensively on the third day about joint venturing and partnerships. How to get other people to work hard to sell products and services for you. How to get other companies who are not competitive to give you access to their markets on a joint venture. How to take fullest benefit from other people's access to markets you want to reach. So, overlooked opportunities are opportunities that are there but that you've never capitalized on because you've never properly valued them. And I'll get into examples later. I'm just trying to give you a little suggestion of what we're going to do. Underperforming activities. This is so powerful because I don't care who you are in this room. On a daily basis, you have going on in your business activities. Maybe you run ads and people call in or come in. Maybe you deal with somebody at the point of in your facility or at their home or office. Maybe referrals come in. Each time that happens, it's an opportunity to increase your results. But you can't increase your results until you first know and measure what results you're getting right now from the activities you're involved in. Let me try to give you a real hard example. Not a difficult example, but a specific example. I had a client one time that was a sales organization of radio stations, and they sold advertising. They had 400 salespeople. And what I do when I look at a business, any business, little business, big business, your business, I want to know all the leverage or impact points of revenue that you're involved in right now that you don't know are happening. With this company, for example, when I analyzed it, they had things like this. They had salespeople who were targeting different kinds of prospective clients that they were calling on. They had presentations they were making. They had follow-up proposals they were sending. They had sales, they were closing. They had subsequent add-on products and services that the buyer would add after they purchased the initial product or service. They had repurchases. They had referrals. They had specific packages they sold to specific industries. And I looked at all of those different activities to see how they were performing now and how they were doing it. Because until and unless you know how you're performing and how you're doing it, you can't improve. It's like if you are trying to run a race and you don't time yourself. You can't. How are you going to get any faster? If you don't watch the strides you're taking, how are you going to get more effective or powerful or efficient? So this is what I'm talking about here. And Spike is your advocate. His job is to make sure at the end of the day when you come back after the break and you ask Spike questions, that I've done a good enough job that he's not going to have to work too hard to answer. So am I being pretty clear? Okay. I'm trying really hard, but we're just going to try to shift and make it real easy for you. We're going to look at undervalued relationships. That can mean maybe in your buyer base, amongst all your buyers, you might have somebody who has incredible influence in a community or in an industry. And if you knew how to capitalize ethically on that person, he or she might get you access to dozens or hundreds or thousands of more people. You might have access to media that could either run ads for you at a discount or run articles for you for nothing that would get you credibility and superior differentiation against your competitors. So it's about focusing on all the kind of relationships you've got. You might have relationships with vendors who could put up money to help fund your ability to either penetrate new markets or develop new selling systems, because they would benefit as much as you if you're successful. But it's not, there's not one thing. And remember I told you, I don't believe in one size fits all. I believe that each one of you are going to have a unique set of requirements that will be best served by picking different custom combinations of all the methods we talk about. But I'm just trying to get you started to think about this. Now I need a show of heads or hands. Is this making sense to you? Person that says right away must speak English. Do you? Am I doing okay? Are they doing a good job of translating too? You can't tell. I'm trying hard. Okay, all right, I hope it's making sense. Okay, underutilized distribution channels. Let me give you an example. I had one time a client, it's going to date me, but I've been doing this for 30 years, and 10, 15 years ago, aerobics was really popular in the States. I had a client back then who had two very fashionable pieces of aerobic attire, like a sweater and a scarf. And they had distribution or sales in 5,000 different retail stores. But their business was starting to decline. And they came to me looking for a breakthrough. And when I analyzed the business, I showed them that their real asset was not the two products they had, it was the relationship and the distribution they had with the buyers at 5,000 other stores, and that all they had to do was get control of other people's products that those same buyers purchased, and get control of products from companies that did not have good distribution, and that they could make a fortune. And they did, and they increased their business almost 10 times. But they had never realized that their greatest asset was their underutilized distribution. I made millions and millions of dollars in the 80s and 90s by going to financial newsletters, people who had subscribers who paid a fee to get investment or trading advice, and I got them to make offers inside their newsletter for my products and services. And I got to ride free through their distribution, and I made millions. As we look at each and every one of your business, the odds are high that you got access to distribution. Distribution could be a sales force. It could be wholesalers. It could be certain industries, certain associations, certain affinity groups, special type groups that you've never recognized are holding so much stored value that you could mine more profitably. And we'll work through that over the next 3 days. I just need you first and foremost to recognize that that's a focus that we're trying to get you looking at. Untapped selling systems. There are so many powerful ways to sell, and yet almost no small, medium-sized entrepreneur uses any of them. Let me give you a couple of quick examples. I'm going to ask a question, and I need a show of hands. I know there's lots of training organizations that have grown up in China. How many of you business owners have been trained in advisory selling, or what's called consultative selling? Raise your hand. Okay. One. How many? Two, three, four. Did it make a difference in your business? Big difference, didn't it? Did it make a big difference in your profit? Good.
It made great difference in the profit, and we increase profitability quite much.
I don't teach consultative selling. I teach people that there are lots of other selling systems, but every entrepreneur in this room should go out and either or do the following. Get a course on consultative and sales training for yourself and everybody in your organization who has any dealing with your buyers, your customers, your clients. Number two, if you can't get a course, buy a CD set. If you can't do that, buy a book, because consultative selling, it's very consistent with a strategy I'm going to teach in a few minutes called the strategy of preeminence, but it's all about guiding the buyer, the prospect, and serving as their most trusted advisor. Having them see you as a guiding force, not just a seller of commodity. Distinguishing yourself well beyond and above your competition. Normally, if you and your team get trained in consultative selling, it will immediately boost your sales performance 10% to 500%, and it will stay there. It's the easiest way to instantly boost the sales of a business, consultative selling. But there's lots of different selling systems. There's risk-reverse selling, there's consultative selling, there's bonus-based selling, there's endorsed selling, and most of you don't do any of that, and that's, instead of being frustrating, that is so exciting because none of your competitors do it either. And if you start doing it and they don't, you're gonna have such a decisive advantage over them as you compete in the marketplace. Little known marketing approaches. There are probably 100 approaches that you will learn about this weekend. Do I expect you to use 100? No. Do I expect you to use 50? No. But if you're using none right now and you add 3 or 4 that are the best suited to you, do you realize how much more powerful and profitable your efforts could be? I just get excited thinking about it. Don't you, Spike? Okay, we've already talked about that. Everything I teach is a universal principle. Everything I teach has worked almost everywhere it has been applied. However, it does have to be adapted, adopted, and modify, because as I said, no two industries are alike. And I'm not suggesting that one thing works perfectly everywhere. So we will be working with the questions you'll ask Spike, with the examples I will give, with the different interpretations that the people at the tables will share, at showing you how many different ways people can have of adapting, of adopting, of applying a concept to their situation. Does that make sense? Yes? Okay. It's a delayed reaction there. Okay. I can't help your business grow until you figure out where you're at right now. And where you're at means a lot of different things. It doesn't just mean what's your sales or your turnover. It means what are the dynamics or the metrics of what you're doing. For example, and it'll change for each company, how many prospects do you have to either get or call on to sell a product or service? How much do you make each time you sell that product or service? How many of the people that buy that product or service will rebuy that or other products or services? What does it cost you to bring in that sale? What does that investment make you in transaction one or over a year? How are your ads pulling? What does it cost you for a lead or a prospect? What does it cost you for a sale? Are there different categories or qualities of buyer that are worth more or less to you? What are you trying to do as far as growth? What has to change in the system you're following to make that growth possible faster and easier? For example, get some water, excuse me, 1 second. Excuse me. Thank you. Let's say, for example, that you have a business that right now has 1,000 active buyers and they're spending 200 RMBs each time they buy from you, and they're buying two times a year. So 100 times 2 is 200 times 2 is $400,000. 400,000 RMBs a year would be what you'd be doing in sales. Does that make sense? Okay. Well, most people don't even know how many active buyers they have. Most people don't know how much they're spending. Most people don't know how often they're buying. But let's say you know that. Well, then you got to know, what are you trying to accomplish? Let's say that you wanted to grow your business to 4 million RBMs or RMBs. Well, unless you changed anything, you'd have to grow all those numbers 10 times, wouldn't you? But there are faster ways to do it. If you got each buyer to buy twice as much, if you got each buyer to buy four times as often, you might be able to shorten the growth and the cost and the time down by 90%. But you can't know that till you first know where you are now. We will, over the course of the next 3 days, help you figure out how many active, how many inactive buyers you got, what your conversion rates are from prospect to buyer, what people are spending, how many different categories of businesses are, you know, profitable or unprofitable, what's working best, what's not working, what you can change to make your business more profitable instantly. But I just want you aware that you can't, if you don't know where you are, it's like me saying, I want to go to Los Angeles. And somebody's saying, well, where are you now? And I'm saying, I don't know. Well, do I go east and west? Do I go north, south? I don't know where. You need to know where you are in terms of the statistics, the performance elements of your business. And you need to know where you're trying to get to so you can decide, do you continue with the same the same business model, or do you improve upon it to shorten the timeline and rise the profitability? Obviously, you want to shorten the timeline and raise the profitability. Am I still being clear? Okay, being clear? Yes? Okay. Good, thank you. Thank you. Okay, so then you got to know where you want to go. And I'm going to share a quote from a very good friend of mine. I hope it translates well. My friend is a person who counsels business owners to great achievement. He says almost every entrepreneur that he's ever met struggles non-verbally, like inside, quietly in their heart, with a question that haunts them. And the question he says they struggle with is, am I worthy of the goal? Can I really grow my business to make a good living? Can I really gain prosperity? Can I really, you know, build an enduring enterprise? Can I really, you know, gain wealth? Can I really get the house I want and car? Can I really be more successful? There's all this self-doubt. He says, and I agree, that when you realize how much more is possible from the time, the opportunity, the effort, the investment, you will change your question. And the new question you'll start asking yourself is not, am I worthy of the goal? But instead you'll start saying, is the goal worthy of me? Because my business and I can do so much more with the opportunity. And that's what I'm after for you. But that's what you got to set. Where are you trying to get to? And is the goal high enough? Is it a goal that's beyond, or is it beneath you? Most of our goals are beneath us. You just don't know how much more you're capable of achieving. Okay, I use a system of breakthroughs, and they're based on four foundations. The reason they are based on these four foundations is I've studied thousands of successful companies all over the world in all kinds of different industries. Almost to the company, the absolute most successful companies in each field tend to be the ones that engineer and produce the maximum quantity, quality, and continuous consistency of breakthroughs in these four areas. Marketing, they constantly come in with better ways to market, more powerful ways to market, more expansive ways to market. Strategy, they're constantly outthinking a business model that's bigger, more powerful, more enduring, more strategic than their competitor. Innovation, remember I said innovation is not necessarily high tech, although it can be, but it has to do with bringing greater benefit, greater advantage, greater protection, greater enjoyment, depending on what the product is all about, to the market. And finally, management. And it's not just managing people, it's managing your opportunity, managing your time, managing your efforts, managing your resources, your relationships. But if you can learn to constantly focus on creating breakthroughs in all four of those areas, and your competitors don't even think about any of those four areas, you've got an immediate opportunity, or immediate advantage.